so much for a nice welcome. What do you say after Father Benedict? It was such an inspiration to hear him talk again, and we had some interview some time ago, and I was more like, oh my God. So happy to hear his comments and his questions. It definitely changed my life in many ways. I'm happy again to be here. So unreal for me still to have gone through what I saw when I was so close to die, and to be able to be standing in front of people like you to tell my story is such a great mercy and such a grace from God. I really don't take any day, any time of my life for granted. I am so thankful, more than I ever been in my life, about the life I live today. And I remember when I was hiding, I used to pray the rosary, which I prayed so much. At one time, I remember I used to say it 27 times a day, just to get up and pick it up and start to say it, trying to mean it, to say it and mean all the words, until like 6 o'clock at night without stopping, which would be like 27 times. And then after that, I would say Divine Mercy 40 times until 10 o'clock. That is all I could do, because we couldn't talk when we were hiding. And at the end of the day, I used to ask myself how it used to be so hard for me to say one rosary. Now I'm saying like 27 times and 40 Divine Mercy. And I said, I wish I can find Catholic people and tell them that it is possible to say the rosary and really mean it when you're in trouble. And I just couldn't believe, like, where am I going ever to find people to talk to? So when I see this, I'm like, oh my God. I'm really, really thankful for that. And I remember struggling, especially this last part of the Divine Mercy chaplet, when you say, you know, like, Holy God, Almighty One, just like, to grab the meaning of Mighty One. Do you mean you can be mighty than the killers? And just like to mean those words, and can this really be? And it meant so much to me to say the Divine Mercy chaplet, because all the time, one of the big struggles I had during that time when I was praying, I felt like it was like the devil telling me that, you are a sinner, stop praying. You think God can ever listen to you? You are nothing to him. And somehow, anytime I say the Divine Mercy, I trust you, Jesus, and I can see his mercy, how big it was, I said, you can't tell me that. He is merciful. If I have sinned, he can say, forgive me. And that was really my weapon, like, yes, he can forgive me. So what now? And then I was able to believe again and to trust that he can still be here, he is here, God, and he can hear my prayer, he can answer me, and I'm his child, he created me out of love. It really kept me very much strong. And I remember after I came out, I found out this about this the DVD, Non-Escape. Have you seen it? There's no escape, is it? Is that? Or Non-Escape? Anyone have seen that? Divine Mercy, yes, in my soul. Is that? Oh, I think they have it here. I watched that Divine Mercy DVD for 2 years, every single day. And every day in that time I watched it, I got something new. Something new, something just came from that story of Sister Faustina and touched my heart, like, oh, tomorrow I can't wait to go to sleep again and just watch it before I sleep. And one part that touched me so much was where Faustina met this person who came as a poor, who was actually Jesus, and come to her very much like shaking and like poor deity. And she received him with so much love, so much care. Touch his hair, remove his hat, clean up a little bit of the dust on his clothes, and gave him food, smiled to him like a human being. And after a few minutes, eating quick, he was really hungry, he disappeared. It was Jesus himself who came disguising under the image of a poor person. That kind of broke my heart, like opened my heart in some ways, like I still watch it today, I said, oh my goodness. Because that is really what to me means mercy, to be able to love people beyond what you see outside. To be able to And that is mercy. Sometimes I used to think that having mercy means to do big things, have an orphanage, have many orphanages, really be like great people who have accomplished so much. Then you see the small things. And that was something that definitely taught me so much. And coming back to my story, that taught me so much. And if I still say it today, it is really because I have learned so much, and also because many people who I talk to almost every week have called me, have sent me emails and mails telling me how my story have touched them. And what comes out of it is not anything I ever thought would ever come out of that, because when I told the story, I was really trying to tell somebody what happened to me and how God was so close to me. And then when I received letters, people tell me how my story have helped them to forgive people. I remember this one person told me that after reading my story, he forgave somebody he was angry with for the past 54 years. And he said, for the first time, I felt peace in my soul. I'm like, how did you do it? Because I don't think I wanted to think like I wanted one to do that. But how people can find inspiration in many ways, I don't even, it's really up to God. And of course, some of them tell me that they were able also to change faith and come to convert to Catholicism, even if I never wrote anything like that. And I truly believe that God judges us from how we relate to Him, how much love we have in our hearts, not that you have to convert. But of course, I like it. And other people tell me how their faith has increased in many ways, and it's such a joy, and it gives me so much strength to continue to give and to share and to see just the fruits that comes of that. And sometimes, of course, I look at myself, I say, God, why did He even leave me? Why, who am I to be leaving, to be doing that? But it is His will, and we should always pray for His will. So I won't go back too much in the story how the whole trouble started. During the genocide, I wrote a lot about in my book, how it all started long time, 1900, how the hatred came to be between the two tribes, Hutu and Tutsis. I came from the tribe Tutsi. We were about 20% of the whole population. And during genocide, how it started, I was a student in college, and I happened to be home for Easter holiday. And when I got there, 3 days after Easter, it was the 7th of April, never forgot, my brother came to me to my room and he told me that the president of the country died. It was the whole beginning of a nightmare of completely between the past, a clear cut between the past and the future forever. And when I came outside, we spoke with my parents, we didn't know what was going to happen. We were very scared, and about 2 days after, we had about 10,000 people around my home. People are asking, like, what are we going to do? My dad was a director of Catholic schools, and my mom was also a teacher. They were much better than financially than many other people in the village, which was very poor. So people trusted them a lot to ask them what they can do. And when things were really getting bad, and each village had about a group of people who were trying to kill, my dad came to me and he said that he thinks I should go to hide. I didn't want to go in the first place, because I thought, what if I go, what can happen to you? But I remember he said, this is an order, this is out of love. I made this decision, you have to go to hide to another person who was from the other tribe, who was a friend. And he said, you have to go there, this is what I'm telling you. And I really left out of obedience. I just didn't want to leave at home, the house, to leave everybody there, not knowing what was going to happen. I remember when I was leaving, he gave me the rosary. It was a red and white rosary, the last gift I ever got from him. And I left. And after I met my hardest capital, of course I'm talking to Catholics, mostly, I guess. And then I had a scapular, really brown scapular. I remember on the scapular it is said, I don't see that anymore. But I remember to say that if you die in a state of grace and you die wearing it, that you will go to heaven Saturday after your death. Even if you die Friday night. That the Blessed Mother will come to take you from purgatory. That when I saw that. And I remember I gave it to my father. Who can I give it to? And I thought, as all the ladies, of course, I loved my dad. I was one daughter, so he was my best friend. I just wanted him to go to heaven quick. if he dies, it was almost like he knew what is going to happen, but I refused to accept that they might die. Remember, I gave it to him, and that was the last time we saw each other. I went to this neighbor, he was a Protestant pastor, and when I got there, he put me to sit in the bathroom. Actually, it was about 2 o'clock in the morning, he came to pick me from one room where he put me. He showed me this small bathroom, 3 by 4 feet. He went back, brought 5 other women. Later, he brought 2 more women. So we were 8 people in this tiny bathroom. And I say that, you know, we might stay there 3 or 4 days. But he said, don't talk to each other, don't make any noise. He said he won't even tell his own children that we're there. Because he said, you never know who can tell any other person who, you know, what is going on and they can come to kill you. So of course we accepted. I remember he even said, don't flush the water over the bathroom until somebody else is flushing the water in the next bathroom. And this was the only house in the whole village that had 2 bathrooms in the same house. I was very surprised, like, we have 2 bathrooms. So he told people in his household that he lost the key of that bathroom. And one guy always was behind him, let's fix it. And of course, in time he told us that, I'm like, oh my God, they're going to find us now. But he never insisted too much. So we stayed there. The first week, I couldn't take the pain anymore. I thought I was going to die. My anger was increasing. How can you stay here? Why me? Why even my generation? Why this have to happen to me? I had my parents, and I was really cherished all my life. I was loved by my brothers. Was loved by my parents as one girl, as you can imagine. Everyone did things for me, to help me out, to give me a hand. So I couldn't, I never been in a place for 1 hour out of punishment or being close in any place like that before. And 1 week passed and I'm still in one place. I thought it was the worst I have lived in my life. And of course I'm still a child in my heart and my mind. I remember talking to myself, if I come out, I'm going to tell my mom what happened. She won't believe it. That I stayed in one room a whole week. And of course, I'm not even thinking that maybe even them, they're going through something like that. And I remember after a week, something came to me, clear inspiration, like, maybe you better find out what to do, what is going on, more than trying to pity yourself this much, or blaming and finding out who did wrong and who caused this to happen. Find out more, what can you do, what is going on. I asked the pastor to put a radio outside and I couldn't believe what I heard. We heard from the radio, from the government people, giving orders to go to kill every one of my tribe. I remember this guy especially who was a government minister, he said that they have killed thousands of Tutsis who run to stadiums, thousands of Tutsis who ran to public places like the churches. Before, they never killed anyone who ran to church. This time they were doing everything they can to eliminate everyone. And he said, these people are not human beings, they are cockroaches. The same thing they did to Jewish people, really dehumanizing you, like, you are just a snake, you are a cockroach. How can you not kill you? And he said, start with the children and even the old people, don't let anyone go, just clean up the country. I just couldn't believe, like, a government minister? This guy had a PhD. They told me all my life that people who are educated are better off, you know, they think better, they are more smart, they know the truth better. We were trained to listen to them. Now, all of a sudden, what now? It was really confusing. And I remember he gave order, again, he was a government minister, he gave order to start searching every home of the Hutus, to see if there's any Tuts hiding one of their friends. You thought my pain was much, just being in that place without sleeping, lying down straight. Now on the top of that, they have to come to search to find us. All of a sudden, I realized how lucky I was in the first week. I complained so much, but actually I was very happy. Now they have to come to search us. The pain increased in my heart, in my whole body. You know, sometimes they tell us that purgatory, yeah, I used to hear that purgatory is like 1,000 needles going through your body, and of course you don't have your body, your soul is in pain. And I used to wonder, at least no one spanks me, how my soul can pain? You know, if no one touches me, how can I suffer that much? So I used to feel like purgatory must be really easy. in that time, I remember like dying slowly, like every piece of my body is falling out of me, just waiting. When are they going to come? When are they going to come to kill us? Are they going to find us? Are they not going to find us? And why me? What did I do wrong? And I remember, of course, I couldn't even remember if God existed anymore. And I never forgot one time they came to search. They came inside the house, I was stretching, they came through this little window, I saw them. Of course, I fell over the ladies and they went through the house. I thought it was about 1,000 people, but later we got to know it was about 300 people. They had all kind of arms. They were dressed in banana leaves, green banana leaves. Some of them have like horns of gods, really trying to look like the devils. And they had machetes, guns, long spears, and they started to sing when they got right inside the house. Sing like, you know, and let everyone, a very nice song, nice rhythm. Inside everywhere, like, check, they searched every single place you can imagine. The top of the house, in the ceiling, under the beds. They even opened suitcases to see if there's any baby hiding. In the bathroom, I can't tell you the fear. I don't even think I can find words. You can feel when you know that somebody who's killing you is like 5 inches away from us. I can remember seeing them like that and hearing them coming inside. The rest, I don't know what happened. I just remember praying to God. I had the Bible. One lady had, I was like putting it in my mouth, like I want to eat it. Like, God just made me disappear. Another thing was like almost like a devil telling me on my shoulder, like, God doesn't exist. He doesn't exist. You think this will happen if he was somewhere? Don't worry about him. My health to exist. This is the only time I need him more than any other time. Then I'm fighting with that. And I remember asking God, if you are there, just give me a sign, because right now I don't have any idea. I'm confused completely. I said, if you are there, just give me a little sign. Don't let them find us today. They can find us tomorrow, next week. At least make me sure that there's heaven, or all I have heard in my family. I remember we used to pray every night, knelt in front of the cross before we go to sleep, every meal before the meal, after the meals, we prayed. But all of a sudden, I realized that maybe I prayed because of my parents. I just wanted to make them happy. I didn't know anymore if God was there. I remember praying, please, if you are there, don't let them find us. That time, they searched every single place. They came right to the door of the bathroom, and before they opened it, they told the pastor, like, you know what, we trust you. There's no way you can hide these cockroaches. That was, after 2 hours, they were everywhere in the house. And then they went back. I remember when the pastor came to look, you know, to see us after 2 hours, we didn't know where they left. We were still like in that fear, like paralyzed completely. And he told us they left. I'm like, you should have told us much earlier. And then he told us what happened, how they searched every single place. And he said, I don't know what you're praying, how you're doing it, but whatever you're doing, keep doing it. Because I don't understand how they stopped right here. In my heart, I remember went back to God, like, maybe God is real, if he can hear me. I was asking him to not let them find the door, because in my human imagination, my human thinking, you know, we are smart, we know what is going to happen. I couldn't imagine how come they wouldn't find one door in a little house of 4 bedrooms, 300 people. Anytime I thought about that, something was like, open the door, give yourself to them, end the torture. Don't even try to trust anything. And then like out of it, oh, God can be doing this. I remember asking the pastor the Bible for me to have it myself. But when I asked him, I just wanted to be sure that I know more about God. Who is he? Not anymore about what I heard. Maybe. I want to read this word and try to understand, like, do you really mean what I'm reading here? Does real heaven exist? Really, if somebody go to heaven, there is a paradise, and there is a purgatory, and there is hell. They won't really exist. I knew that they never existed then. But do you mean that if we do this, if we love, is the greatest thing, then can we have peace? Then everything about the Bible was coming to love and forgive. Then I started to go through this battle. How do you forgive? God, I hope you didn't mean this. You didn't know that the killers will come to kill us. Then maybe you will not have talked about forgiveness. No, something was telling me, no, he knew about it. I remember that time, anytime I stopped like reading the Bible, trying to understand, Like these poisonous thoughts were jumping in my heart, in my head, started to tell me how they're going to kill me, how they're going to rape me, they're going to cut my hands, they're going to do this before this and that. And I was so scared. It would feel so painful. And then beside the fear, it was always my anger. If I only come outside, I'm going to kill them the same way they're doing it. And you know, when you're angry, you can be very creative. You just think about things you can do. And what could have done justice to me was maybe to take like a bomb, put it under the country, and blow everything up. That was the only thing maybe was going to give justice to the anger I felt. Even if I die among them, that was fine. Because you couldn't believe people who are our neighbors we lived with. My father, my mom, they have done so much to help. Now they are killing us? You just don't understand that. You know, we knew our tribe was discriminated, but not to the extent of being killed. I had so much anger. And one time I felt like it was too much to be angry. I couldn't even remember how to smile anymore. It was just like my stomach was hurting all the time. And one time, just like a little angel, there's always those little two voices. One is always giving you little good ideas. Another one is like, forget about it. Discouraging you. One thing, well, why don't you just start to pray, say the rosary, and then maybe your mind can cut a break from those bad thoughts, and then you can come back later. I started to pray the rosary. One rosary, I felt so good. Like I moved from the bathroom to much this place where I felt like I took a break. Then after I ended it, these bad pictures again ran to my head. I'm like, okay, let me say it a second time. So I ended up saying it the whole day. The second day, I did it. It felt so good, like I moved from that place to another place. Then I said, okay, I can say it all the time. That's when I started to say it. And one time I counted, how many do I say a day until 6 o'clock? I'm like, oh, 27. And then I said Divine Mercy until 40. I knew I wanted to say it 40 times to meditate on the time Jesus was suffering in the forest. So 40 times I had to do that and finish and fall asleep. It felt so good. And one thing I realized through that, anytime I say the prayer without meaning the words, I still find like the devil finding a time to go in my mind, again show me how I'm going to die, how angry I can be. Even if I'm saying, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with me, they were always parallel. Then I said, okay, I have to ring in the words I'm saying so that the devil will find a place to go in. And I remember one part I remember a lot that gave me a hard time when I started to try to be sincere with my prayers, when our Lord is prayer. I said our Lord is prayer, just the beginning, our Father, I couldn't move from there. You cannot be the father of the Hutus. You are only the fathers of the Tutsis and the foreigners. No, the Hutus, they are killers. There's no way can be their father. Another thing is that, yeah, he is the father, actually. Who is actually very suffering because his children are choosing to kill, but he's the father. Okay, I can take that. Then I went to this part where they say, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. That one I said, okay, you know where I cannot mean this. There's no way I can mean forgive them. And yet I want your help. I can't continue to lie to you. So I want to mean that. I remember one time I said, okay, the only way to be sincere to God is to skip that part and say our Lord's prayer without that part. Truthful. And I did. And then after time, I remember I said this little again, the little voice in you, this little inspiration, something was like, I hope you know that that prayer is not man-made prayer. Every man can make a mistake, but not Jesus. So he's almighty, he can't lie, he can't make a mistake, he knew the past and the future. So if you really want to believe in him as that God who is almighty, don't try to edit his prayer. Maybe find out what he meant. Then you can be happier than trying to change what he said. It was not easy to take. I can say this laughing now. No, that time it was more like I am in the laboratory trying to find out what this means, what this means. Really trying to be truthful. Then I remember in my life, I never knew. I knew that word before, but you know, sometimes you don't understand what it is. What is compassion? I tell you, we have compassion, and then you're like, okay, I know what compassion is about because I'm feeling it. in my life, I don't think I knew what it meant to surrender until that time when I felt like I'm so powerless. I can't forgive them. I can't continue to lie to God. I still need to pray. I have things to hide. What do I do? And remember, I asked God, I surrender. It felt so good and so heartbreaking and so humbling. Like I cried like a child. I surrender. I put everything in your hands. I still need you, but I don't know how to forgive them. And yet, I still need to pray. Now I put everything in your hands. If you know how to do it, if you know how to forgive, just help me out. Teach me how to do it. I'm going to say these prayers. If I can forgive, you failed me. It's not being really fair because I asked you to help me to forgive. I remember going through again the rosary. Now I'm seeing the life of Jesus. I'm seeing him on the cross. For the first time, I started really to feel like the love he loved me. Up to this day, the sorrowful mysteries, the movie, the Passion of Christ, nothing proves to me how much I'm loved, how important I am, than those places where he's suffering. And I try to see everything like as though I was there. I remember wrapping myself around his cross, like I'm seeing it, he's on the cross, his blood is falling over me. I'm like, I'm not going to go. Don't let them find us, please. And I can feel what he was feeling. I can see a mother who is brokenhearted, seeing her child dying on the cross. It became so real. And I remember last time when he was on the cross, he's dying, and he said, forgive them, Father. They don't know what they do. It was a time I understood what it was to forgive. If they knew who Jesus was, if they knew he was God, his heart was full of pure love for them, even them who were killing him, they would not have done it. Who doesn't want love to be loved? But they don't get it because the blindness of the sin and the anger and the fear, they couldn't get it. And somehow it translated to me that even the people who are killing us, there's no way they can get it. They can get the consequences that will come to the country after they have done all these killings, the consequences that will come to their children, to their families. I knew they didn't get it. And from that time, I felt like God have all these, so many children, some of them, a big part, are deciding to go astray, to hurt other people, other children. And I can feel his pain as a father. And then I started praying for the killers. And for the first time, I felt that almost like I moved from the bathroom to this beautiful place where I was just in my heart. I was so happy inside. And I was just seeing only the love of God. I felt that if I have learned that lesson, if I can see how these people, what they have done, and I can still pray for them, maybe it was only purpose I was in the bathroom. I really felt like I forgave them. And we ended up staying in that bathroom for 3 months without speaking, talking to each other. And when I came out, the bodyguards who killed, they have run away from the country, and the Tutsi and the Hutus, who were moderate, those who were against the war, from outside, they came fighting, they won the war. When we came out, I was 65 pounds, completely a skeleton. I can count every bone in my body. But somehow I was so strong inside, like, I can't fall. I felt like the hand of God was there telling me, don't worry, I am with you. And I remember having a dream of Jesus. He told me, if you continue to love, if you continue to trust in me, to hold on to me, when you come out, everyone you left behind will be killed. But if you continue to hold on to me, I will do even more. I will be with you. I will do even more than what your parents would have been able to do for you. And in truth, when I came out, everyone was gone. My two brothers were home. They were killed. My mom, my dad, my neighbors, my uncles, my aunts, my friends, my schoolmates. It was almost like the end of the world. A million people in a country small as Maryland State was killed. Everywhere was dead bodies. But somehow, the prayers I have said, what I have discovered in God, it felt so real, so strong. And I can witness to you that I know for sure that there is heaven. And this journey we are taking, we have to take it with passion, we have to love as much as we can, and we have to go through it, and we still have to go on, and because this is not our life to me. This is where we have to prove that we can be overcome the challenges, and our challenges to me is all against love. against you not loving a neighbor because the neighbor is overweight. I remember being a skeleton like that, and people are laughing like, oh my God. And in my heart, I'm like, I am much more beautiful. I think I'm much more stronger. And I'm laughing at them because the person I was, I've grown up. And what was outside was completely like nothing. And then they are mistaken because they're just looking here. They can't look what is inside. So many things I learned through that experience. Up to now, the way I got somebody who took me to the home to live, how I found my first job like 2 months after the genocide, just like trusting. I still say my rosary every single day. I still say the divine mercy. I just see that when you trust in God, everything is possible. It is truly possible, nothing is possible. I remember writing this book, I didn't know what was coming out, and I made the publisher 3 days after I have just finished the book. Someone just have to ask me where I came from, and when I told him, he said, have you thought about writing a book? And like the whole month, I was fasting, saying the rosary, reminding the Blessed Mother, you say it, if we say the rosary, nothing shall be possible to you. To tell you the truth, I say the rosary even when I'm trying to lose weight. And ask the Blessed Mother, you say that we can obtain anything. As long as you are sincere to her, she's a mother. What is a mother to us? Is that person you talk to, this little secret? We talk to people, they judge us, but she can't judge us. I say all this little thing. When I'm looking for a friend, if I have a little problem with my friends, I go on the side, I say my rosary, try to meditate on it. And then when I come out, everything's great. Something's going wrong on the job, and you say the rosary, you talk to the mother, help me out, come to my help. You're looking to have a friend, to meet somebody in your life, you feel lonely. To me, the rosary has become such a friend to me. And even God, and of course God, the whole rosary is about Him. I think I have got a relationship. Of course, it's never perfect. I'm growing. Don't even see me as anything like a saint or anyone who is like have gone so far. I think I'm more tasty after I have tasted His love. I write Him letters when I can't figure out what I'm feeling or what's going on in my life. Sometimes I send Him emails. Of course, they come back. But He never failed to answer prayers. Even if it is to give you what you want when it is not good for you, and then teach you a lesson from that. I trust that. Actually, I have a CD I made of the rosary, and I would like to give a gift to anyone who is trying to meditate more on the rosary and who wants to commit to saint every day. Let me see who can do that. Somebody? Yeah. And you too?
And give it to the sister.
A sister too? And before I end, I want to invite you to go with me to the Holy Land in April. I have brochures behind. We have a group. I can't believe you. It's my first time I'm there. We'll be talking with the whole group. I can't wait to go. And just to put my feet where Jesus and put His feet, I can't wait. So it will be great to go. Before I end again, I remember somebody told me, actually the person who helped me to publish the book, he always told me, if you are conflicted between choosing to be right and to be kind, if you are conflicted, because sometimes you don't have a choice just being right, but if there's a conflict between, always choose to be kind.